Transformation. Wow. Man, let me say this. First of all, welcome to another broadcast of the Hush No More podcast. And boy, am I fired up today. I have two of the finest, most legendary professional basketball players to ever do it on the Hush No More podcast today. And, you know, I am so wound up that I don't even want to waste time with this. I got to go straight in. I'm going to introduce to all of you, Dr. George Tinsley Sr. He was born in Louisville, Kentucky. He went to Kentucky Wesleyan University. He was a three-time Division II champion for Kentucky Wesleyan in 1966, 68, and 1969. Three-time champion. He's a two-time Division II tournament most valuable player. He was a two-time Division II All-American, drafted by the Chicago Bulls, played 4 years in the ABA, was inducted into the Kentucky Wesleyan Hall of Fame. His jersey was retired at Kentucky Wesleyan. He was inducted into the Small College Basketball Hall of Fame. He also owns and operates over 60 KFCs and other restaurants all across this country. He is the creator of Turning Obstacles 20 Opportunities Platform. He is a motivational speaker, a coach, a successful businessman, a father, a husband, and a great man of faith. I present to you all the great Dr. George Tinsley Sr. George.
Yes.
How does that feel when you hear it played back to you? Some of those things that you've accomplished.
Well, it sends a chill every once in a while up and down the old man's back, you know, to think about years past and all the fortunate opportunities that I've had to excel and be a part of a team concept. So it's exciting, and I appreciate the emphasis that you were throwing on it there. So I'm just honored to be on your show.
Hey, you might as well get used to it because I'm going to be putting some respect on your name throughout. It's coming. Let's bring in our second guest, who is Kym Hampton. She also, like George Tinsley, was born in Louisville, Kentucky.
Thank you, because you knew I was going to correct you, right?
I can see. She said first, before you do anything else, stop saying Louisville, because people from Louisville will correct you every time, and I still keep saying it. That's Louisville. Okay. I stand to be corrected. But she was born in Louisville, Kentucky, like George. Two legends out of that state. She went to Arizona State University. She became the all-time leading scorer, rebounder for Arizona State. And to this day, 30 years later, those records still stand. Kym's jersey is forever retired at Arizona State University. She was inducted into their Hall of Fame. She was drafted as the number 4 pick in 1997 of the WNBA Elite Draft of the WNBA inaugural season to the New York Liberty, where she played 3 seasons before retiring. The WNBA New York Liberty would later honor her into the New York Liberty Ring of Honor. Kym also played 13 years professionally all over the world in Italy, Spain, France, and Japan. She is a model who modeled for CoverGirl, Lane Bryant, and Ashley Stewart. She's a singer who has performed all across this country. Kym is an actress who was featured in Essence and Glamour magazine. She is a color analyst, a sports consultant, a coach, and above all and everything else, she is a mother. She is the mother to Ariel Jackson, who currently plays on a full ride scholarship to Cincinnati University. I welcome everyone to Kym Hampton. I gotta ask you the same question. What do you think when you hear all of those accomplishments when I read those off? What goes through your mind?
I think sometimes us, as we're living things like that, I think we just have a tendency to be like, okay, it's enough. Oh, don't talk about me so much. I don't know. Sometimes you forget how wonderful those accolades are, but I think it just takes me to a state of gratitude, especially now, just to a state of gratitude.
Well, you know, I think we should give great honor to both of our guests by kicking this show off with two video clips.
And longtime supporter of the New York Sharks and Fins Up Foundation, please welcome Kym Hampton.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proud we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming. And the rockets rang clear, the bombs bursting in gave proof.
Wow.
The night that our flag was still there, still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave.
Awesome.
So awesome.
Let's go.
Let's go. But guess what, George? We're not the only one who thinks that was awesome. Go ahead and do the second one for us, please.
Yeah. I got the head. Finish it. All right.
So that was Kym with Ayanna Irish. So Kym, what has it been like for you to sing the national anthem on so many amazing stages in front of so many getting an opportunity to do a duet with Ayanna Irish. I mean, your life has been incredible, but let's talk about that voice.
Wow, it has been an honor, but the truth of the matter is I've been singing all my life, but I was incredibly shy, had incredible stage fright. So I really didn't start singing in front of people until my adult, I'd probably say somewhere in my 30s. And it was actually, yeah, it was definitely my 30s, because when the WNBA started, I was 35, getting ready to turn 36. And the first opportunity that I got before I stepped on the court, Madison Square Garden court as a player, I sang the national anthem at a Knicks game. So that was almost like my first coming out. And when they asked me to do it, I was like, oh yeah, you know, wow, my God, that'll be, you know, epic. Oh my gosh. And then when I got there and saw 20,000 people and everybody standing up looking at you, I can remember that. Now the microphone is so hot and it's so loud, right? I can remember walking like this and saying, oh my God, what did I do? And I heard myself up there and I was like, you know, I was like, it's been a wonderful experience. And still, but still to this day, the national anthem is one of the most scary things that you could ever do. I think anyway, just for me, it's just because all of that attention and everyone is looking at you, and it's not that I can't execute the song, but it's just, you know, it's just, I don't know, performing in front of that amount of people. But if I'm singing anything else, I'm good. So it's really, really weird, but it's such a blessing. And then now getting the opportunity to really start singing more and being out, living out here in Portland and getting more and more on the music scene. I just feel grateful that I'm just able to share this gift. And it's been
a dream. What a gift it is. You truly blessed us with your talent. And, you know, it's just amazing that you could be such a legend in basketball while simultaneously having such a great voice. It is just like, how, my goodness, you're an actress and a model and all those things. But, you know, we're going to get more into it about your career and all the things that you've done. But I also want to get back to George, who, again, another Louisville legend. Let's take a look at his legacy.
God is there.
No. Hey, Tiff, at the end. Tiff, number one. Number one. Number one for George of his highlights.
George Tinsley, Kentucky Wesleyan College. George Tinsley helped lead Kentucky Wesleyan to the NCAA Division II National Championship in 1966, 68, and 69, and became the first player to start and win three NCAA National Championships. Between 1966 and 1969, Tinsley started a record 20 NCAA tournament games and was named to the All-Tournament team in 1968 and 69, earning MVP honors in 1969. He was named to the Southern Region All-Tournament team in 1967, 68, and 69, while earning the Regional Tournament's Most Outstanding Player Award in 1968 and 69. For his career, he finished with 2,014 points, 1,115 rebounds, and was named First Team All-American in 1969. Tinsley was named to the NCAA Division II Elite Eight's 50th anniversary team and the NCAA Division II's All-Decade team. He was also the first Division II player to be inducted into the state of Kentucky's Hall of Fame. Tinsley was selected by the Oakland Oaks of the ABA and the Chicago Bulls of the NBA in the 1969 draft. George Tinsley, Kentucky Wesleyan College, and inductee into the 2017 class of the Small College Basketball Hall of Fame.
I get goosebumps. I get goosebumps watching that. George, I'd like for you to walk us down what it was like for you growing up in Louisville, Kentucky, and how you got to the place where you chose Kentucky Wesleyan, and just give us a narration of your journey.
Well, first of all, Leslie, it's Louisville. Louisville, right?
So we don't pronounce the S at all.
Just hold a little bit longer and you're right there. But, you know, and I'm honored to be on here on your program with Kym, who I've always followed her career. And she's a multi-talented young lady that has been good in everything she's done. She has been an outstanding representative for our city of Louisville and the state of Kentucky, which we have supported her all along. So for me, in a different time, in a different era of time, you know, coming out of Louisville as a basketball player and as an athlete, there was a lot of competition in the area. So, and I was the first to have an opportunity in my family to attend college. So it was quite an experience. Not knowing where I was going, what I was going to face. I had a couple of high school teammates who had gone on to Kentucky Wesleyan, so I felt comfortable going there. But talent wise, there was so many great players there in Louisville: Butch Beard, Wesley Unsell, and all of those names that we all came out about the same time. And major colleges were not recruiting black athletes across the board. Typically, University of Kentucky wasn't even recruiting black athletes at all. Let me take that back. They had recruited Wes Unsell, but unsuccessfully the prior year. So it was a different time. Kentucky Wesleyan, my high school coach, or the high school coach where I attended Mill High School, he had gone on to Kentucky Wesleyan. He had recruited Dallas Thornton, who was a teammate of mine. And so I just kind of followed that path. I visited some schools, but, you know, terms that were being used, like, you know, we don't have very many Negroes here. The things of that nature just made you, you know, nervous about even being involved outside of your comfort zone.
Yeah.
So Kentucky Wesleyan was a was a nice fit for me. A small college, low self-esteem, and coming out of Smoketown in Louisville, Kentucky, a different section of Louisville than Kym came from. But it was an honor to have the opportunity. So going through Kentucky Wesleyan was probably one of the greatest periods in my life, 4 years that I was there. Should have won four national titles.
I know that's it.
A guy by the name of
Earl Monroe. We never get over it, do we?
Yeah. Well, a guy named Earl Monroe that you all are certainly familiar with. His team went to Salem and beat us. But I didn't play that game, so I got sick because we took a tour of Africa and Europe during the summer after winning the first championship. The second year, my sophomore year, which we had our best team on paper, we had three guys that made All-American, including myself. That's the season we lost to Earl, and I was sick in the hospital, so I didn't play. So I don't take credit for losing that particular I tell my guys all the time. But it was a great time, guys, that I look back on now, and probably I would probably compare my college career with anybody out there in the 4 years I was there and all of the different academic honors that I received, athletic honors that I received, and my alumni honors after leaving there. So I don't think there's an honor that the college gives that I have not received, as well as being on the board of trustees and back on again as a trustee emeritus, and you know, just representing the college around the globe as I've traveled.
You know, I really appreciate you talking about the racism aspect, because I was going to tap into that. I want to talk about, because yes, you won three titles, but you won those titles in 1966, 68, and 69, where racism was definitely at the forefront of this country. And I'd like to think, but I want to hear it from you, that when you won those titles, I can only imagine how you were able to bring the races, our races together. Can you talk to us about what that was like to see Black people, white people, everybody coming together, celebrating, running on the floor together in the 60s, because this great man, George Tinsley, helped to bring Kentucky Wesleyan a title?
Well, and let me just clarify, it was a team effort. It wasn't just George Tinsley. It was we had a great team, a lot of great teammates. And we had a lot of students at Kentucky Wesleyan, which is in Owensboro, Kentucky, that were from the Northeast, which the racial tensions weren't as high there as they were in the South. So a lot of the student body that was there had experiences, had gone to high school with Blacks, and it was an easier transition from them. For a lot of some of the students at Wesleyan were from the rural areas of Kentucky, who had never actually been around or had Black teammates. So we, that first year, our coach made it a point to bond, and we started three Black players in my freshman year, the other two All-Americans that I spoke of, Sam Smith and Dallas Thornton. So he made sure that we worked together on and off the court. The great thing about that group, too, was when we won the first national championship, we went to Europe and Africa and traveled together as one group. There were three Black players and the rest all white. And so that bonding took place that whole year. And my freshman group, which was five guys that came in at the same time, we got even closer, and we matriculated through the 4 years of Wesleyan, and all five of us were the first group to ever graduate from the college. And a guy by the name of Joe Bolden, who I grew up with there in Louisville, Kentucky, he and I were the first Blacks to graduate as athletes, as Blacks and athletes at Kentucky Wesleyan. So it was a melting pot. And of course, during those times, Martin Luther King was assassinated. Bobby Kennedy was assassinated. And so a lot of things were happening around the world and in the communities, but we had a strong group of guys that just kind of stuck together and watched each other's back. So and we still maintain a relationship today.
Beautiful. That's beautiful to hear.
Yeah.
Kym, when you listen to George talk about all of the things that he faced, we're listening to him describe in real time how he paved the way for you, players like you, out of that state and all across this country. I want you to reflect on what we just heard.
Wow. I think that is so incredibly awesome. I was born during that time. I remember, you know, like the assassinations. I was a little girl, so I didn't understand a lot, but I saw the reactions of my parents and my relatives and how that affected and impacted their lives. And even just growing up, as you become a teenager, you always know that there's, you know, racism in America. But us, even as women, we had to face a different type of racism because during that time, also Title IX was started. So not only did we have to, us as females, women, Black women too, did we have to face the racism in that we also had to face the fact that we were women. And so, I just remember even me going to college, and by that time, all colleges, all Power Fives were recruiting Black kids because they knew they needed Black talent in order to compete and to win. But, you know, it makes me feel proud that he was one of the first to graduate as an African-American male, because, you know, I was listening and I wanted to ask you what happened, Dallas and what's the other?
Sam Smith.
Sam. They didn't graduate.
They didn't graduate. They came back. Dallas came back and graduated later on. He went on to the ABA, but he came back and got his degree later on.
Okay. But that even speaks to the program as well, because that they show not only athletic support, but they show the academic support as well. And so that was really, really huge. So, I just feel proud because you have always been a stand-up gentleman in the community, and you've always stood for what's right, and you've done it in such an eloquent way. I mean, you're you know, as a educationally, just socially, and whenever I see you out, we're at whatever event, everyone loves George. So
everyone loves George Tinsley.
Yeah, I'm just like, and I do, and I feel proud to say that you're my friend, and to say that, you know, we come from the same hometown, and you know, just all of the things that you've done. So I'm grateful, and I just want to say thank you for being the light, just for being a bright light for not only African Americans, but for athletes, for businessmen, business people, and just for being a great husband, a great father. Just everything that you do, I just thank you for paving the way for us and just being a bright light.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
And at this moment, I'd like to go to number two for George. Let's look at the second video clip for him. While we're on the subject of him being a great athlete, I would like to transition a little bit. And the second video.
Born and raised in Kentucky, George Tinsley launched several companies, including Tinsley Family Concessions. His extraordinary success in concessions and franchising was due to his overwhelming ability to overcome obstacles. It's also his motivation to now share that wisdom through speaking, coaching, and advising under his company, G.W. Tinsley Consulting Group.
Times got tough. It's time to kick it into another gear and make that happen. And understand that it's not the end of the world. When you run into a roadblock, you just got to figure your way around it, over top it. Or
when I think of George Tinsley, I think of my at the childhood in Auburndale, Florida, when I would grow up, when I was going to basketball camps and Little League baseball, the Tinsley name and family were everywhere in Polk County where I grew up. And when I also think of George now as an adult, I think of overcoming obstacles with opportunities.
Overcoming obstacles with opportunities. Let's talk about who George Tinsley is today. Tell us a little bit more about your company and how you just transitioned after basketball.
Well, let me start with right after my basketball career came to an end, and as each of you know, we get fired at some point. It's a business, and if we could continue to play of our choice, we'd still be out there trying to make a dollar and enjoy the game as well. So, fortunately, or unfortunately, in the ABA. Every day was a new day. Yeah, you didn't know for sure whether the team was going to make it throughout the entire year. There are only a few teams that that actually were what I would call stable. And even those, there were a lot of moving parts that were going on behind the scenes. I didn't realize it at the time I was playing, but it was a business, and
yes,
and those things were happening. So it was really an experience. So fortunately, I had an education and had a fallback position. I just got married. And going on and trying out with different teams just was not part of my game plan at that time. So I decided to go back to my old high school, male high school, and become a teacher and a coach in track, cross country, and basketball. And that began my career. What I always wanted to do was give back to students there, given that the coaches were a big part of my life as I went through male. But eventually, at some point, and of course, we won some state championships in track and in basketball. I was fortunate enough to be able to be a part of the coaching of Daryl Griffith, who was one of the greatest players to ever come out of Kentucky, out of Louisville, Kentucky. played at University of Louisville and on to the Utah Jazz. But after a point, you know, there wasn't enough money coming in from coaching. I enjoyed it, but that came to an end. And so I had to find a career. And as I bounced around from looking at the FBI, which they offered me a position, and then in the meantime, I worked at Kentucky Fair and Exposition Center doing a number of different things there, which were all new experiences, but I enjoyed. I got an offer to go to work at Kentucky Fried Chicken as a trainer because of my teaching background. A guy by the name of Walt Simon, who played in the ABA, was actually there working. That opportunity opened up a door where, you know, the colonel, the real colonel, he and I worked together in the training department, training new franchisees and existing franchisees. And I just fell in love with that. The same energies that I used in basketball and athletics, I transitioned those right into the business world. And it just caught on fire. I worked for the corporate world 8 years and learned all the different departments, roles to a VP and within. And then I got an opportunity to become a franchisee and poured it right into that. All those skills I'd picked up playing athletics and teamwork and leadership and everything else, it all worked right into the corporate experience. And then of course on into my own business. Along the line, I happened to marry my sweetheart from college. We were both king and queen on campus. She was the only black female at Kentucky Wesleyan. She came from Louisville,
what?
Kentucky. And Kym, as you know, her father owned the radio station WLOU there in Louisville. So she came to Wesleyan. She was, as I said, the only. My story is that she followed me there, but her story is she she decided to come there. But we hooked up and in my junior year and dated. And as I said, we were king and queen of the campus and, you know, a number of other different
so
things
beautiful.
That we excelled in. And so we got married in 72. I don't know how much time, I don't want to take away all Kym's time, but that was 72 was a time that changed my entire life. I was adopted and I found my mother and my father in 1972, as well as getting married in 72. As well as the team in Miami folding and going to New York Nets that year. So that was a real turbulent year for me. And I had to make some real hard decisions with a lot of emotions going on. But all of that, going through all of that, prepared me for this business world and getting out there and understanding what's more important, most important in life, and that is family. Relationships, and I've always used that in our business to grow our family inside of the business and all each of the different businesses we have. So yeah, we're still living the dream, being highly blessed by God and thanking Him every day.
I love how you established your foundation first, which was to the missus. Nothing else feels good or really matters until you secure that love.
That's right.
And so you guys got married. That was beautiful in 1972. And what you're being shy about not mentioning is how you own over 60 different restaurants. Do you want to talk to us a little bit about that?
Well, I've kind of lost count of, Leslie, of the number of restaurants we have. We have quite a few in Tampa, Florida, Miami, Louisville, Kentucky, and we were on the street here in the Central Florida area. So we're transitioning now where my son is now has become the president of the company. And so
very nice.
That's our legacy that we're leaving for him to take it to the next level. And he's doing an outstanding job of doing that. And so, In some of our markets, we're in the airport business primarily now, and take a market like Miami. Things change on a quarterly basis sometimes, where we move units. There are concessions inside of the airport at P.F. Chang's, Payway, Starbucks, Wendy's, and Chili's, nice. and of course KFC and Bourbon Academy there in Louisville, and a number of different brands that sometimes we kind of change from one unit to the other because mm-hmm. of contracts. But I got into that business with the TGI with TGI Fridays back in 1995. And that TGI Fridays is we opened that and that became the number one TGI Fridays in the nation for 9 years in a row. So
wow.
that's what opened the door in the airport business for us. And because of that success, we just got opportunities all over. As a matter of fact, we literally had to start turning some of them down because it was just growing and moving too fast.
But I just love the fact that as athletes, you know, we you have to have discipline and you have to be able to listen. You have to be able to work with others. You have to, you know, be a great team member. All of the things that helped you later in life to be one of the most successful businessmen in the country. And so I definitely wanted to bring attention to that, your great success there. But also, Kym, let's talk about your success as a model. This was going on while you played in the WNBA and even after you played in the WNBA. So I'd like to watch the clip. Bring in number three.
Uh-oh, I'm scared. You pulling stuff. I'm like, I hadn't seen.
Bring in number three for Kym. Don't be scared because you guys, your greatness speaks for itself.
Wow, George, you were about to say you had a great, your great partner as we're waiting for the cue. Your great partner. You were going to say something about your wife. Okay.
Kym Hampton and I stand tall. Standing tall is being able to say, okay, this is who I am. This is what I have. I am a mother. I am a singer. I am a former WNBA basketball player. And I got drafted in the elite draft in the first round. I was the number 4 pick to come and play for the New York Liberty. For me, confidence was something that I've struggled with pretty much all of my life because I was always taller than everyone. And I just didn't, you know, I didn't fit in. You know, now if I can look back, speak to my younger self, I would definitely say, own your height, love it, be proud of who you are and what you've been given, who God created you to be. Finding my fit in clothes and shoes has been a lifelong problem for me. I never really had that love for clothes shopping like all of my friends. When you're talking about the sleeves or the sleeves on a dress or the length of a dress and where a dress should hit you and the bodice of a shirt or a dress, you know, it just lands and hits you in the right place. That is just an amazing feeling. So I love this line because they are listening. They get it. They finally realize that the tall plus girl has been left out. This is a universal line, and I want every tall plus size girl to feel comfortable, to feel beautiful when they step out. I am tall, and I am Ashley. Are you ready to stand tall?
I love that so much.
Yeah, you know, and I wanted to kind of cap that off. I said I struggle with you know, self-esteem and things like that, because number one, growing up in Louisville, Kentucky in the 60s, it was still, you had the racism, but then you had, along with the racism, there was that light skin, dark skin thing. And I grew up in a family where both of my parents were light skin, and a lot of my family members, you know, I have an Aunt Carolyn who was just a knockout, a lot of my cousins and family members were all light skinned, and then I was dark, and then I was just as tall as my dad, and you know, and so, and although I wasn't heavy all of, you know, I wasn't heavy all of my life, but still I wasn't the average size woman, so I was always intimidating to guys and men and things like that. So I think that's where a lot of that came from. I was like, oh my gosh, I always felt like the ugly duckling.
That's unreal to hear you say, because when we see you and the world sees you and we watched you on TV, all we saw was beauty. And then when we saw the ads like this on Ashley Stewart, you were a cover girl model. I mean, talk to us about that journey.
Wow.
Of your career.
The craziest thing, now, the cover girl was something completely different from what we just saw, that the video that we just saw. I never will forget, and this is the honest to God truth, I was vacuuming the living room in New York. I was vacuuming. And then all of a sudden, Fred, the father of my daughter, called me. He said, hey, Kim, he said, did you know Queen Latifah's holding auditions for her new cosmetic line for CoverGirl?
Oh.
I was like, really? And she's like, he was like, yeah, it's open call. And it said BBQs, you know, BB King's on 42nd Street. And I was like, huh. You know, just something just said, huh. And then he was like, you should look into it. He said, you should call somebody. And I was like, okay. And I kept vacuuming and it just kept weighing on me. And I said, I said, let me make some calls. So I called this one woman, her name is Jill, and she manages and produces all kinds of shows. And so I knew she would have a contact there because they were saying the line was around the corner, you know, and all
that.
It was freezing cold. I was like, yeah. I don't know about that one. So anyway, I did. I called her and I got right in and I was able to go and audition and I got a call back and I went and auditioned and then I got another call back. And then I never will forget, we went to Kentucky and we drove actually to Kentucky. And on the way back, I can remember having my feet up on the dashboard and I was doing something and all of a sudden my phone rings. So I grabbed it and I said, hello. And they were like, hey, Kim, this is such and such, you know, from CoverGirl. And we wanted to let you know that you are one of the CoverGirls. And I was like, what? And so, and from that, it ballooned into a national commercial. So I'm surprised you guys didn't find the national commercial on the CoverGirl thing. Mm-hmm. You're slipping. No.
I'm slipping. I don't know where that is. I wish I could get a redo.
I'll show you where it's at. But anyway, and so, yeah, that ballooned into that. And it was just amazing. We got to spend the whole day. And I know Dana, Queen Latifah. I know her well because she's, you know, lives in the New Jersey area or lived in the New Jersey area. But it was just really cool just shooting that whole commercial with her. And so it's been up. And then how the whole other modeling thing happened. I was, you know, when you're playing in the WNBA, I want to say it was probably my second year, I think. And you get a chance to go to all of these galas and all of these events and all of these, you know, A-lister events. And so I was at this really nice party and I was talking to someone came up to me and was like, oh, my gosh, who do you model for and everything? And I was like, oh, I don't model. And they're like, you're kidding me. Oh, my gosh. And so that prompted me to I signed with a company called Click. And they're the ones that got me. So I was one of the original Lane Bryant girls. When they started the V line, I was one of the original V girls.
Wow.
So that prompted that.
Amazing.
Yeah. And then when I got signed with Wilhelmina, you know, then I went on and got signed with Wilhelmina there in New York. So it's so funny because all of my childhood dreams when I was a kid, I just envisioned I wanted to grow up and be a model and I wanted to be a singer, you know, and things like that. So it was just really cool to be able to actually see those dreams come to life, you know, but everything took the back seat to basketball. And basketball was a lot easier because, again, I was really, really shy. And then I doubted my beauty. Like, you know, I just knew that my beauty was a different type of beauty. And you know, as a kid, you know, it's hard for you to, I guess, to unpack or to navigate that and just to understand, okay, beauty comes in many varieties and you have a lane somewhere. So,
yeah. But I love how you were able to capitalize on all the gifts that you have as a basketball player, making it to the WNBA, playing 13 years professionally all over the world. Then you had this dream always as a child, you know, to be a singer. To this day, you sing on stage all across this country. The modeling, you were shy, as you mentioned, but, you know, once it was brought to you, you just stepped straight into it. And so, you know, I really admire how you found a way to make your gifts an opportunity. So what do you say to that, you know, to other aspiring young girls who, you know, might be as shy as you are, but they have a dream and they're listening to you today? What would you say to them?
I would say in this day and time, you have so many more tools than we did back in the day. I mean, George, when you stop and you think about as an athlete, when you look at everything that these athletes have, you know, they understand things from nutrition, training, different ways of things. I mean, you have all the computers and the logistics of everything. I would just say if you are smart, learn from people who have already gone through it and weathered the storm. Learn how to avoid a lot of the bumps. And, you know, it's kind of like my daughter. It's so funny because, you know, I'm mom to her. And so she's like, yeah, whatever. But all, you know, some of her teammates are like, really, you know, they're eating every word that's coming out of my mouth. And I would just say, learn from people who have already done it, you know, and just set goals and really start developing that discipline muscle at an early stage. Because I think us as human beings have a natural tendency to want to just have instant gratification.
Yes.
And a lot of times we don't say no to ourselves when we could or should, you know, like you take a Kobe Bryant, you know, most of the guys in the NBA, you know, Allen Iverson, I just watched some video clip where he was talking about how great Kobe was. He was like, what you doing tonight? And so he said, Kobe, I'm going to the club. I mean, we in LA, right? You know, I'm going to the club. And he was like, what you doing? He's like, I'm going to the gym. So, you know, I think if you can just be disciplined enough to learn from people, to watch, listen, and learn from people, and just to put that work in, I think that you can do and achieve a lot of things that you might not even know and understand what's possible.
Yeah. You know, listen, people are looking right now at you guys and they see, you know, Dr. George Tinsley, you know, senior, who is this great successful businessman. And they see Kym and they've just played the clip of you modeling and singing and you made it to the league and they see all this glory. But the purpose of my platform, Professional More, is I like to get light shine on the fact that we struggle, right? We've had difficulties. It hasn't been always glorious. Some of us come from humble beginnings. Some of us experience tragedy. We experience losses. So at this point in the show, I'm going to do a small pivot because I want to get into a little bit of a cutting edge. Tiffany, if you could go to number three for George.
Well, from the inner city to a big city, in honor of the last day of Black History Month, we're introducing you to a Tampa entrepreneur who began with very little, but has built an empire of his own right here in the Bay Area. His life story is not only uplifting, but also quite inspiring. Walking into the offices of George Tinsley Sr., you might be distracted by the awards and trophies this self-made millionaire has accumulated for more than 30 years as a restaurant owner. Each plaque and picture telling a different story of how he's turned tragedy into opportunity.
This is the first restaurant caught on fire.
But there's one story not on the wall. At just 7 months old, George was abandoned by his parents, left to be raised by the woman he would eventually call mom. He grew up in a poor Black neighborhood filled with drugs and violence.
Outside of the house, the women and men in the neighborhood who were grown-ups, they also counseled, and you took the good from the pimps, you took the good from the prostitutes, you took the good from the gangbangers. You just kind of developed an instinct, at least I did develop an instinct, what was right and what was wrong.
When George was 13, his adopted mother died. A life-altering event that could have easily destroyed his confidence. But around that same time, he met Gay Howell, a junior high teacher who reached out to George with a simple gesture, placing him in the audiovisual squad at school.
Made me the guy that went around and set up the projectors in the different classes that as they were showing films and so forth. So, you know, that gave me something to really feel good about.
Once in high school, that self-assurance contributed to three things: his skills on the basketball court, academics, and the introduction of the young lady that he would end up dating in college and even marry. He would go on to start as a freshman at Kentucky Wesleyan and help win three NCAA Division II championships in 4 years. After a short stint with pro basketball, he began his career as a training instructor for KFC. Today, he owns and operates more than 60 restaurant franchises, mostly in Tampa, and this year celebrates a 20-year milestone of ownership of the TGI Fridays at Tampa International Airport.
Don't let any obstacles that you're feeling hold you back from being who you want to be and going where you want to go. And the challenge is to break through the barrier.
Clearly, that's what this family man, Bay Area businessman and civic leader, has done.
And George also says he loves mentoring young people. In fact, he considers it his responsibility. He visits schools all year long in the Bay Area. He speaks at USF often, has a think tank made up of young people, and works closely with 100 Black Men of America, Inc. at Hillsborough Community College.
Wow. So awesome.
George, the name of the title to that segment was Abandonment to Success. And I want to tell you, that strikes me different because I am the mother of two adopted boys. And it's very personal to me, the question that I'm getting ready to ask you. I need to hear from you and for others who struggle with maybe, you know, not knowing their parents or maybe grew up in a difficult upbringing with the parents they were given, or maybe didn't have a father in the home or mother in the home. Look at you. And today I just played that segment, and we're also talking about the fact that you are so successful. Can you talk to us, people like me, and talk to us about the difficulty, the issues that you may have faced, and how you were able to figure it out?
Well, Leslie, I'll say that I'm just concluding autobiography. It's going to be called Catch as Catch Can, which is basically turning obstacles into opportunities. And it will dive deep into my life. So for the listeners, stay tuned and be. Hopefully you'll get a chance to read the story. But it would take me an hour to tell you the whole story, but it was God's plan as to how this all unfolded, how I wound up with this lady who kept children, and my mother just wasn't there, whatever that story is. Still today, I don't know factually what happened. My father, later on when I found him, who claimed he didn't know anything about me. And my name was George Pennybaker. And how that Pennybaker got to Tinsley, I have no idea. You know, in the schools in those days, I don't know if they did all the record checks and so forth. And I didn't even know what my birthday was. I'd been celebrating my birthday on September 27th, but it was actually after I did get a hold of my birth certificate. It was September the 19th. And just a number of other different things. So my self-esteem had always been very, very low. I had an odd-shaped head. I was taller than other kids. I got caught in the integration in the fourth grade to the fifth grade, and my sixth grade school, I got put back a year because we weren't at the same level as the kids at the white school. My sixth grade school teacher called me up in front of the whole student body, and she was upset. I was clowning around, and she said, "Why don't you just quit school? And, you know, go get a job because you're not going to make it." You know, all of those things, different obstacles happened in my life. But each time I faced one of those challenges, I was able to push through to the next level and make the best out of it. I think all of us as athletes who are successful athletes and those who are successful in other careers, you run into these kinds of challenges, but you figure it out. You don't let it beat you. You don't become negative. You stay positive. you find someone who will help you get through over that next hurdle. I remember the prostitutes in my neighborhood right across the street that all the guys were hanging out over there for various different reasons. And so I would go across, and for some unknown reason, they would say, you know, you get your ass back across that street. You don't belong over here. You're going to be somebody. And I didn't realize what they were saying, but I got back on the other side of the street, you know. And so, you know, as I said, this guy was looking out for me. This lady who had one leg, couldn't read or write, and got a small check each month. She did everything she could to take care of me. And when I went out that door, she had no clue where I was going and when I was going to be back. It was just her and I, but I knew I had to get back to take care of her. And so I stayed out of trouble. I got into my little stuff, but I stayed out of trouble. So, you know, what you're doing for your sons, believe me, they will greatly appreciate it. I'm sure they do now. To have someone to love them and take care of them and be there for them and provide guidance. So it's it's another reason why I have the obligation of giving back. Kym, you asked me a question there at the end. If it wasn't for this lady, my partner, my wife, I wouldn't be where I am today either, as a success in business and other endeavors, because I know she's got my back. She's equally successful. Nothing I do, I don't take the whole full credit. It's both of us as a family to be able to accomplish things. So there's always going to be somebody out there in your life or in your path that if you keep a smile on your face and you're not negative, they're going to reach out for you. They'll help you, you know.
Yeah. I mean, Kym, I want you to speak to hearing that, you know, how he was raised, and we've been talking about what a great man he is. Just how would you reflect upon what we just watched?
That your life speaks nothing to me but God orchestrating perfectly your life. When you stop and you think about it, the woman that he placed you with, and then she died at 13, you could have gone to the streets, you could have done anything, but somebody else, was that the woman that you're talking about that had the one leg that stepped in and took care of you? Is that who you're talking about?
No, she was the lady that took care of me at 213. Her son and his wife took me in after that.
Okay. But you still had formed a family. You had bonded as a family with them. And then you went on, you know, you graduated, you went to college, and, you know, you graduated from college. When I hear that, like you said, all I can think about is, oh my God, God had his hand on your life the whole time. You know, he purposely separated you from your parents and, you know, placed you where you needed to be and all of those opportunities as a trainer. And then you become a franchisee. Excuse me. And it's just so amazing just to see how, you know, it just seems like God would open up a door here and you're like, and he had prepared you to be able to step through with confidence or else placed around you all of the people that were there to guide you and just to orchestrate your move to success. It's just amazing. Wow.
It's an incredible story. Yeah. I
hope you have all of that. Like, I hope you have the details, because I know this interview is very, very short and I want to ask you so many questions. I'm like, oh, okay, I can go off. I can call them up and ask them, you know, the questions. Yeah. But yeah, make sure you detail that stuff to the fine lines, because
we are definitely going to have to promote his book. I mean, this is not going to be the end after this interview. This is definitely going to have to be to be continued, because I think we all are getting the feeling that there is a lot that we need to hear, a lot that we need to discover. And there's a lot that he can say that will heal and bless so many of us. And so we look forward to your book, and we'll definitely be promoting that here on the show. Kym, you've had your career 13 years all over the world. You retired after three seasons playing for the New York Liberty. And you basically was one of the very few who get to retire out, but you retired out because you were injured. Tiffany, I want you to go ahead and play clip number four before we get into some of the hardships that Kym had to face with injuries as an athlete.
Yeah. I actually really didn't have an injury. It was just wear and tear.
Yeah, wear and tear.
Over the years. You know, your cartilage starts to wear. And, you know, after a while, the doctor's like, look, okay, are you going to, don't you want to walk after you stop playing?
And so, you know, decisions got to get made.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay.
I played 6 years in Spain, 4.5 years in Italy, 1 year in France, and also 1 year in Japan. And during that time abroad, they started the WNBA, and I played the first 3 seasons of the WNBA. I had the daily aches, and I think I started getting my knee drained when I was in college. So it was, you know, our tendonitis would always flare up. I've taken some anti-inflammatories in my day. You know, I used to rely on them pretty much. If you have to miss games, that someone could come in and do so well that, you know, it's kind of like, well, do we need that person? No player wants to sit on the sidelines and be injured. I have just daily pain and the stiffness. I've lost considerable range of motion in my right knee, which was the knee that I've had 2 scopes on. But now as the years continue to pass, my left knee is now starting to have more and more pain. I felt like I was in safe hands. And I think that for me, that's one of the things that's going to go over really, really well with the athletes. Once they see that it's not something that you're just giving them and you want them to take, you know, this is a collective decision that will be made in their best interest as an individual. As an athlete, and you're playing on a particular level, at that level, you experience day in and day out pain. Where were you when I was playing? It definitely could have helped. And, you know, and the beauty of it is it will help, you know, athletes of today and athletes that move forward. A lot of times us as athletes, our lives are dictated to us. You know, if the team trainer says this or the team doctor says this, okay, we just kind of roll with it. We don't usually ask questions. If we truly have the best interest of our players or the best interest of our craft at hand, we will look to continuously grow and seek out new things that will help us to improve and get better. So for me, I just say to doctors, to trainers, to everyone, to athletes, you know, continue to educate yourself on what's new and get better and, you know, try something different.
Mm-hmm. So that was an ad that you did for a particular product. But as you said, you had your share of wear and tear and walk us down. Talk to us about the moment when you knew, okay, this pain is becoming a little bit too much for me to bear. And maybe it's time.
Well, that was the end of the 3rd year of the WNBA. I was sitting out that 3rd year. I had to sit out of quite a few practices. It was just because in the WNBA, you have that 8-month season just that's condensed down to about 4 months. And so it was like you were playing every other day, some back-to-backs, and then you were traveling. And so, you know, just being up and down in the air, all of that. So your body had very little time to recover and recuperate. And so when you're having knee injuries and that's that constant pounding, it's sometimes your body just needs a rest, or that joint or whatever it is needs that rest. So I decided I was at the end of the season, I was going to have another scope, have that scope. And then I was just going to retire. But then about a month later after, you know, recovery and I was rehabilitation therapy, and I was back in a month and I wasn't feeling any pain. I was like, oh my gosh. Like, and I was still in shape, you know, cause it's only a month later. And I was like, huh. So my teammates are like, come back one more year. Because we had gone to the finals twice. And they're like, one more, come on, Kym. And I was like, all right. I'm like, I feel good. I'm like, okay. So I come back and I'm in day three of training camp. I show up and my knee is just swollen like this. Mm. And I'm just like, oh my goodness. And it didn't really, really hurt, but it was just a lot of the wear and tear, you know, again, of what training, you know, like preseason will do for you trying to, you know, you're getting in a lot of hours of movement and things like that. So for a solid week, I was getting therapy. and nothing would help. Nothing would make it go down. So I ended up having to have another scope just to go in and explore it. And it was like an exploratory scope just to see, you know, if I had torn anything. But he was just saying it was a wear and tear. I had severe wear and tear. Like it was like bone on bone right behind my kneecap. And he said, I can have you back in a month and, you know, like 3-4 weeks. He said, but the same thing's going to happen because you're not going to have enough recuperation time. So he was like, you know, and don't you want to have some type of quality of life after you play? You know, so he was like, you're 38. He was like, how much longer are you trying to play? And so it just hit me like a ton of bricks and it was just gone. You know, it's just like, wow. You know, so.
I want to talk more about what happened next. About you having to then face that moment that, okay, basketball is getting ready to end and you beginning the phase of needing to navigate what's your new career going to look like. So let's go to clip number five for Clint, for Kym. Because we know all too well as women, you know, that it's difficult. There's a struggle after we play.
It was great, you know, and then too, because it was new, so it was even bigger then than it is, you know, than I think it is now. Because you know, even the guys in NBA, because it was on TV all the time, and, you know, the commercials building up to it. We got next the whole marketing campaign surrounding it. It was just, you know, it was just amazing. So, I mean, and it was just amazing to be the first, you know, again, me and Lisa Leslie did the first ever jump ball, you know, because LA and New York were the first two teams to play. And we played on CBS, national television, you know, the world was watching, and it was just amazing. You know, it's an ongoing process, you know, it's been kind of tough and it kind of ebbs and flows because I've had a job in corporate America working in the front office with the New York Liberty. But to me, I find that that's not where my passion lies. So I think it's finding your passion and then trying to earn, you know, and then earning a living at doing what it is that you love to do, what it is that you want to do versus just having to have a job just to survive. And so that's been the tough part for me. Just, you know, really trying to monetize, you know, doing the things that I love to do. So it's an ongoing transitional part, you know.
An ongoing transitional part. And I think that I can speak for you, but there won't be a greater spokesman on this conversation than you. But I think for all of us who once played in WNBA, I find it constant in our conversations that we're always still seeking new opportunities, trying to still capitalize on our gifts and our passions and in our new careers. So talk to us about that transition difficulty.
Yeah, well, I think number one of the biggest obstacles that happened for us players that actually, when we graduated from college, had to go abroad and play. I think one of the biggest things, I mean, it was wonderful that we got to go overseas and play and we were making great money while we were playing. But what that did, it also separated us from the opportunity to get, you know, have those business opportunities or to work or to intern or to just build those business relationships. Because again, I was away for 13 years and they start the WNBA and then I'm back in America. And when I end my career 3 seasons later, I haven't built any type of business relationships because you get so overwhelmed and engulfed in me as a starter, as a player, I was an all-star, you know, and things. I still had a lot of speaking engagements and I still had a lot of events. So those were the times. And I always laugh because I say us as athletes, our lives are handled. You know, it's like, okay, go here with this. This is training season. This is this time. Our lives are pretty much handled, and especially if you're like an elite athlete, you know. And so not having someone to say, okay, hey, you need to start thinking about what you want to do. You need to start thinking about, you know, the money you're making is great, you know, and things like that, you know, where you can put that money. So I think for everyone and anyone, I think those are the biggest misses in life that people can have, to not have someone that they can look to help guide that path. But again, you have talents, but if you, so say for example, I'm the person that can step up on the stage and I can sing, but I'm not that business person that can say, okay, this is what I want to do. This is how I want to do it. This is how I want to, because I believe that we're all blessed with our gifts and our talents. You know, each one of us are blessed with individual gifts and talents and the things that we can do. And sometimes more than just one gift and talent. So I've been blessed, shall I say, I've been blessed to still be able to work with the team that I play for, the New York Liberty. And it was a great opportunity too, because I got a chance to work as a freelancer. So they would just kind of send me the schedule. And then like, even with the Knicks doing stuff with them, they would send me the schedule, you know, Kym, what appearances do you want to work? You know, here's our schedule for the month. And so if I knew I had a trip, you know, I wouldn't plan anything, but I would work, you know, this week and I would work that one, just going to various, you know, speaking or showing up with the groove truck or doing things like that. You know, it was wonderful because I felt wonderful in, you know, just being able to interact with people and kids and things like that. But then things start to shift and things start to change. So as the market flows, you know, all of those dollars that, you know, you can toss for all of these appearances that you're paying people starts to dwindle. So it's a lot of ebb and flow with that. And, you know, it was tough when it was ebbing, and, you know, and it was wonderful when it was flowing. But I think for me, the toughest thing was to just understand how I could make this, all of this and what I have, work for me. And, you know, so it's you know, just sometimes you just need a mentor, you know, someone that can kind of help you just organize things up here and get it going. So I would just say to people, to younger people, while things are flowing, while things are hot, definitely seek out people that can help and can guide you and lead you to do the things that are necessary, because you're playing now, but you're not going to be able to play for the rest of your life. And you want to build relationships. You want to try to make that transition as smooth as possible.
George, earlier I had Kym comment to one of the things that you were saying. Right now, I really would love for you to respond, because I'm sure you've talked to many of your basketball brothers and you watch them struggle. The ones who, you know, get waived, they get cut. Like to Kym's point, you know, a lot of the players who play to 30, 35, 36, they've never had a career position outside of sports. How do you consultate your basketball brothers and sisters?
Well, I just, you know, always talk to them about having a fallback position, having something that they'll be able to fall back on if, in fact, their career comes to an end. At any particular point, whether it be an injury or whether it be a trade or in career-ending contract, you know, whatever that might be, but, you know, just having a fallback and doing something with your spare time. When you have spare time, when you have downtime, look at opportunities that may make sense to you, that you might want to invest in, but always do your due diligence and work through those with either through having a consultant that you work with and a trusted agent that you have, or I think in our alumni group, there are people who are successful and in different careers who have played and now have stepped out. Partner up with, pick up the phone, call someone, and find out some advice from them that might help you. I mean, I get calls all the time, and when I was involved on an ongoing basis with the Retired Players Association, we did a lot of that, communicating with guys that are playing and ones that had just recently stopped playing, and trying to help guide them in different directions. It's a great fraternity that exists today that wasn't there back in the day that you could pick up the phone and call. I'll never forget meeting Junior Bridgman on a flight one time when I was working for KFC and he was still playing, and he and I talked about business and what the restaurant business was like. Yeah, I did not know at the time that he was partnering up with a guy that was involved with Wendy's to purchase for Wendy's, and which started off his career in the restaurant business, and he was still playing. So that's one of the guys that probably one of our, as in the basketball world, probably the most successful athlete that has gone on and developed a career in the restaurant business. Is of course he's expanded to other things now, but that's what you have to do. Come out of yourself, open yourself up to meeting other players that are out there doing things and seeing where there might be an opportunity as you continue to participate in your career.
And so I will say this.
Can I just ask you a question? So what happens if you're like someone like myself, like I didn't want to go into business per se. I always had these other dreams. Like I wanted to sing. I always wanted to, get into modeling, get into acting and doing those things. What do you say to people like me?
I say to people like you and like me, as we experience these singing opportunities, there's other doors out there that you can take a look at as you pursue that one career that you're pursuing, but there's side things that are going on. Avail yourself to those. Go to meetings, go to receptions and meet and greet people and, let them know who you are and let them know what your interests are and so forth. Both of you know that people out there in the world, they want to be around us. They want to talk to us about basketball. Well, talk to me about business. I'll give you a little tidbit here, but give me something in return of what you're doing and how you're successful. And I'd like to come hang out with you at some particular point, have lunch, have dinner, and see what you do. They love it. They love to be around us as athletes and singers and so forth. So open yourself up to that. And there's little things that the low hanging fruit that you can grab onto, and that no telling what that might lead to.
Thank you.
Oh, well, speaking of gifts and talents and how things can open up and go from one thing to another, let's go to clip number four for George Tinsley.
Oh, boy.
Your turn.
As these clips move on.
What? Hey, George, you didn't tell me he was a dancer.
He's leaving stuff out. Get it, George, get it.
He's got money. Big boy, right on his feet.
Yes, work. Work.
What was that commit, George?
I didn't tell you all I wanted a dance contest.
What was that? What event was that?
With the stars. That was a local event, a fundraiser that we have in the community every year.
Oh, wow.
I was going to say, you thought you were going to leave some stuff out, but I got you.
I came right back in the next clip. It's out there where I came back in a white suit, and then I did the James Brown and the split and with the coat over the shoulders and, did that whole thing. That's always been that little thing in the back of my mind. I wanted to be a singer and a dancer, Kym.
Oh, wow.
So, Kym, you're not the only entertainer. That's a surprise. You're not the only one.
So, can you sing, George?
No, no, nowhere near. Like,
well, I'm just saying, but can you hold a tune? Can you sing?
Yes, just a little bit.
Oh, okay, we're going to have to do a duet then. Yeah. We're going to have to do a duet.
Okay. If I could be wrong, but I think Tiffany is saying that she found your CoverGirl commercial.
Oh, yeah.
Go ahead and let's take a look, because we're about to close out the show.
Okay.
Tiffany, did you find the CoverGirl commercial? If so, press play.
Thank you, Tiffany. I mean, thank you for all you've done.
Our skin is beautiful and deserves a makeup that celebrates our beauty. So I created one for you.
Woo!
And called it Natural Hue, because that's what it gives you. A natural hue so true to you and a silky finish so luminous, it's preferred 2-to-1 to the leading department store compact. It's an illuminating moment in makeup from women of color. New Natural Hue from the CoverGirl Queen Collection. Everyone.
Yeah.
Easy breezy, beautiful cover girl, Kym Hampton. She is.
Yeah, she is.
So there you are with Queen Latifah, who you call, oh, Dana, my friend Dana. Oh, okay. I'm sorry. We only know her as the Queen. Yeah. So we're going to end this show by talking about, you know, what do we still dream of? What is it that Kym and George still wish to check off that list that I know that you guys have? George, we're dreamers. Let's hear it.
George, will you go first so I can think about this, please?
Okay. Well, you know, my goal is to leave a legacy, to take this book that I'm developing and be able to speak to those out there, to let everyone know you can be whatever you want to be, if you just put your mind to it, you work hard, and you live a good quality life, give back. You know, you can achieve at whatever level you can, as hard as you work. It's there for the taking. And today, with all of the craziness that's going on in the world, it even opens up more opportunities for those who have their heads screwed on right and who want to be successful and achieve things. And there's always somebody out there that was willing to help. You just have to be willing to ask for a little bit of help and show that you know you appreciate, you want to get in there and do and be a contributor. So life is short. Take advantage of every day. Get up in the morning with a smile on your face. Thank God that you got another chance to go out and be the best that you can be and achieve whatever is out there. And if you don't get it today, come back tomorrow and let's do it.
That's right. That's right. All right, Kym, you're up.
All right. Well, I think I think that I want to really allow my light to shine. I want to just step confidently in the gifts and talents that I have. I want to continue to improve in other areas. And I really believe that by doing that, it also will allow people to, it will draw people to me, shall I say. And that way I can share the message of, you know, what George just said, for example, you know, every single day, you know, show gratitude, get up, go out there and give the best of yourself. And if you can't accomplish everything that you set out to accomplish today, you have tomorrow, if you're blessed with tomorrow. I want to do that. I believe that I have a natural gift that draws people to me and people open up to me and they tell me, but I want to continue to just get better as a person. I want to continue to, just utilize my gifts and my talents. And, you know, I want to, if dreams are free, I want to win a Grammy. I want to travel the world. I want to do some more. I want to do some modeling. Like, I want to do some of the fun things that bring me joy, but I want to help people get better also along the way. I want to tell those girls, those tall girls that feel awkward, you know, girl, you better rock your height, because I'm telling you, when you get in your 30s and you know, we naturally as women start gaining weight, you know, that height is going to help you. I'm trying to tell you, because, you know, and now I just want to just to be able to talk to people and to speak to people and just to let them know, listen, you know, it's so easy for us to get down on ourselves and to not understand who we are and to lack confidence and things like that. But I guarantee you, if you start investing in yourself, if you just believe, and just because where you spend your time, what you spend your time thinking on, I mean, that's what's going to grow, because those thoughts turn into beliefs. And so those are the things that I want to do. I want to continue to get better and improve and just help people around me get better and improve. I don't want to, I could just kind of go on, but that's what I want to do.
Well, listen, you both, I can't thank you enough for coming on to the Hush No More podcast. The things that you guys have talked about today was absolutely not just impressive, but some of the information was just stunning, I think, too, that will probably be stunning to some of our viewers. But what I want to do is end today with my way of saying thank you. I created something for you both on behalf of the Hush No More podcast, because you've achieved so much, and it's like, how do you get it in an hour and a half broadcast? So this was my way of trying to get it all in. So let's go to the amazing life story of Kym Hampton.
What? I thought you was giving us $1 million or something. George, you don't need it, but
this is a gift.
You see where you're gonna be, growing, getting better. You're not the person they see. Can't be mad at the things you've been through, cause they built your muscle.
Wow.
Now you're stronger than you've ever been. They can't stop your hustle. Your faith ain't never small. That's what brought you this far. Oh, yeah. See, you got your dreams and you got your prayers and you got your God. He gonna take you there. Hit the floor, say a prayer, start working. You gotta do something. It's all right to crawl before you walk. Yeah. It's all right to walk before you run. Yeah. But if you wanna get what you never got, gotta do something that you never got.
Thank you, Kym.
That was good.
Thank you. That was good.
On behalf of so many, we salute you today.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
And let's go, let's take a look at George to close. Look at his tribute.
God is able. God is able, and he won't fail. God is able. God is able. God is able, and he won't fail. Tell me who can make a mountain move out of my way. Who can make a miracle because of my faith? And when the doctor says no, who can still say yes? And when I'm in trouble, who's right there to help me pass every test? God is able. God is able. God is able, oh, and he won't fail. Tell me who could make a river out of a little stream, and who can tell the clouds to roll back so that the sun can look at me? And who can tell the wind to whistle through the trees? And when I'm in trouble, who's that same God that will come down and rescue me? God is able. God is able. God is able. And he won't fail. No, he won't fail. He won't fail. Don't you dare give up. Don't you dare give in. God won't fail. Oh, God is able. God is able. Tell you God is able, and he won't. No, God won't. He won't fail. God won't. He'll never leave, never forsake. No, he won't.
Dr. George Tinsley, Sr., we salute you. You are a national treasure. You paved the way for so many of us. And I just hope that we continue to get this message out and people can see this, see that all the two of you have done. It is powerful. It is impactful. I'm inspired. And you've touched so many, and we thank you.
Melissa, thank you, and I've enjoyed being on your program, and being on the program with Kym again, who I love the young lady, and wish you all the success in the world, both of you, that you are able to achieve your dreams, and if you work hard, you keep focused. I listen to Kym, all the things that you just mentioned. If you just every morning getting up, thinking about those things, going to bed, figuring out what you still need to do and back up and doing it again, you're going to be everything that your heart desires to be. And Leslie, the mother, taking care of those two young kids and promoting mental health and all the things that you're doing. I'm honored to work with you on the membership committee. And both of you are going to just be great. So keep doing what you're doing and keep praying God's help, and you'll be able to achieve those things.
May God continue to bless you. All right, Kym, you got the closing.
Oh, wow. I thought that was it. I don't want to follow that, but I thought that was great. So can we leave it right there? I second all of that emotion. That was well said. Thank you so much, George. Thank you. Thank you. And thank you for being a beacon of light and hope and love to so many. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, y'all. Till next time.
All right, George. We gotta catch up. Look, George.
Okay.
Right. I love you. Okay.
Bye, you guys. Right. Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.
Yep.